Yeah, I'm gonna start just 1 second. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته brothers and sisters inshallah ta'ala we're gonna hopefully try to get straight into the topic and straight into mashallah the life of this great Imam al-Shafi'i. And in my personal opinion, out of the four Imams, I would say that Imam al-Shafi'i had the greatest impact. And in my personal view, had the most knowledge out of all of the four a'imma. And I think that it's very, very important to speak about Imam al-Shafi'i and his life, his travels, some of his shuyukh. I'm not able to, unfortunately, today go into some of his students because there's so much detail I'm trying to cover. And obviously his manaqib, his like good character traits and works and things like that. So, يعني, who was Imam al-Shafi'i? Imam al-Shafi'i, rahimahullahu ta'ala, who was this great Imam? Number one, when we say Imam Shafi'i, the word Imam in Islam obviously linguistically means like a leader, someone that's a leader, Imam. And you know, there's other derivatives of this word, Imam, you know, someone that's in front. The Imam is in front of somebody who, in front of the prayer, he leads a prayer. So an Imam is considered like a pioneer in their field. He's an Imam of something. So when you look at, for example, this laqab, this name given to someone, Imam, it's not given very lightly. So some ulama, you just say Imam, you just say their name. Somebody might say, for example, Ibn Abdul Barr. Even though he's an Imam, you can call him an Imam. But you have some ulama, you just might say their name. And then you have other ulama where you say Imam. Everyone always says, for example, Imam Shafi'i, Imam Ahmed, Imam Abu Hanifa, Imam al-Baghawi, Imam al-Tabari. There's certain scholars where it's as if the whole Muslim ummah has agreed that this person is an imam, is a leader in al-Islam. He's of the highest caliber of knowledge and wara and taqwa. And Imam Shafi'i is clearly from one of those people. And his name is Muhammad ibn Idris ibn al-Abbas ibn Uthman ibn Shafi' ibn Ubaid ibn Abdi Yazid ibn Hashim ibn Muttalib ibn Abdul Manaf. So he's Qurashi. He's from Quraysh. He is from Quraysh. His lineage goes back to the lineage of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he's Qurashi. He is Qurashi. And this is going to cause some problems. This is going to cause some problems for Imam al-Shafi'i in his life. And يعني, even in that, حقيقةً, there's a lesson sometimes that يعني, sometimes just by virtue of where you come from, you can sometimes inherit problems that you yourself have nothing to do with. So maybe a person is born into a particular tribe and that tribe is seen a certain way. Maybe they're seen to be lofty or they're seen to be lowly. You have nothing to do with the way your tribe is perceived or the way your people are perceived. But because of the way people perceive them, you are now judged according to that particular thing. So maybe a person may come from a certain ethnicity or certain background, and maybe people, wa'iyadhu billah, look down on those people. That person might be the best of Bani Adam. He may be good akhlaq and this and that, but for a reason out of his control, he's treated bad. So we as Muslims should obviously try to stay away from that. Ala kulli hal, Imam al-Shafi'i is born and is of Qurashi origin. And this is going to cause him some problems later on in the future. And inshallah ta'ala, we'll touch on it, but we'll touch on it very, very lightly, inshallah ta'ala. He was born in Gaza, so he wasn't born in Mecca. He was born in Gaza. Gaza, which is Gaza, like Gaza, when you hear about the Gaza Strip or anything like that, in Palestine. He was born in Gaza in the year 150 after the Hijrah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So between him and the Hijrah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is 150 years. He was born as a yatimul ab. He was an orphan in terms of his father. He never had a father. Imam Shafi'i didn't grow up with his father. And he was also very poor. So he's of lineage which is considered Islamically to be lofty lineage, in the sense where lineage doesn't get you into Jannah. Lineage doesn't get you into the, it doesn't put you to hellfire, it doesn't put you into Jannah. But in terms of the way people treat one another, people take lineage into consideration. If Prince Charles was to walk into here, people are not just going to chat to him like someone selling fruits on a market stall. You're going to, oh, it's Prince Charles, but he has the same blood as anybody else. He just happens to be someone from the royal family. So because of the way we look at the royal family, we say, oh, this is someone who needs to be respected, or something like that. So he's from lineage where, yani, you could say that it's a lineage of people that that Muslims revere, coming from the tribe of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Not from the direct lineage, he's from a subcategory of Quraysh, but he's Qurayshi or Qurashi nonetheless. However, he grows up as an orphan and he grows up very poor. He grows up very poor. So he didn't have that much qillatu dhatil yad. He didn't have that much, yani, he didn't have that much growing up. He wasn't someone that had a lot, but he was incredibly intelligent. Imam Shafi'i is very intelligent. And this is something we're going to explore, and we're going to start to realize that this man, he differs from the other a'imma. They were all intelligent, but Imam al-Shafi'i and his intelligence is, yani, his intelligence was, yani, something which was amazing, which is like an ayah from Allah, like a sign. So he grows up very, very poor, doesn't have, yani, that much money, but obviously, yani, as the mu'allif, as the author of one of the books that I looked at, yani, he says that, yani, like a person who grows up, maybe he might not have money, but he was taught by his mother, his lineage, he was taught about where he comes from, and he was taught about, yani, his family history and his background, which made him not behave like any other person. The fact that he was Qurashi and came from Qurashi lineage, it made him want to act like a good Muslim, you could say. He wasn't trying to say, oh, I am Qurashi, I'm better than anybody else. He was never like that at all. But he said, subhanallah, yani, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made me from the lineage of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I come from the same tribe. So that pushed him in a good way to act as a good Muslim, okay? And he tried his best, you know, to obviously practice Islam as a young person. And he memorized the Quran very, very quickly. And he didn't take part in what, yani, people maybe, or his peers of that same socioeconomic group, he didn't do the same things that they may have done. So Imam Shafi'i goes on to memorize the Quran in his youth, very young. وظهر ذكاؤه في سرعة حفظه لكتاب الله. And he memorized the Quran so quickly that, yani, they said, subhanAllah, this person, this young boy, yani, his teacher said that this guy, or this young boy, shall I say, memorized the Quran so quickly. It's sometimes it's a hibah, it's a gift from Allah. Now, some people they're blessed with quick memorization, and it may be seen as a form of intelligence, especially in his time. After he, yani, memorized the Quran, and he's a young person, he has the ability, he might not be an adult, but he's like a young man, even 12, 13, 14, he makes the decision that he wants to start memorizing the ahadith of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he starts memorizing ahadith, of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he also starts to memorize shi'r, he starts to memorize poetry. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِنَّ فِي شِعْر حِكْمَةٌ أَوْ كَمَا قَالَ, that indeed in shi'r, in poetry, is hikmah. Sometimes even in poetry, there are subliminal messages, there's a hikmah that can be passed down when a person memorizes poetry, especially in that part of the world, especially in the Arabian Peninsula. They were not a people that used to read or write, they were a people that depended on oral tradition. So the memorization of poetry was very important. However, yani, even though I said that when he was around 12 or 13 or 14, he went to memorize a hadith, at the same time, when he's a young man, he goes to live with a qabila, an Arabian tribe in Mecca, but not in Mecca, on the outskirts of Mecca. And this tribe is known as Hudayl. Okay, Hudayl. They're still around today. And Hudayl, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's time and after, were very fasih. They were very eloquent in their speech, because in the Arabian Peninsula, different tribes have different ways of speaking. So people from the middle region of the, and I'm talking about even now and in the time of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So in the time of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the people from Mecca and Medina, Ta'if, they may have their way of speaking. They may have their names and what they call things. The people of the middle region have their own way of speaking. The people in the southern region have their own way of speaking. Just like in this country, you have people from the north, Scotland, Ireland, the southern part of England, people speak differently. Al-Hudhali, this tribe, they were known to be extremely fasih. They were known to be very eloquent. So, يعني, Imam al-Shafi'i goes and lives with them for 10 years. At the same time, the Islamic Imara, or the Khalifa, or the Khilafa, shall I say, the Khilafa al-Islamiyya, the Islamic Khilafa, يعني, the actual kingdom, the Islamic state is expanding, and it's ever expanding. And what ends up happening is that many people are entering into Islam that are not from the same ethnic group as the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came, he only spoke to the Arabs. There were some individual people like Salman al-Farisi and other people who, they were ethnically not Arab, but the bulk, 99.9% of who the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave da'wah to was to his people. And then after he died, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam and the companions of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam spread Islam. And that was the point. The Islam is not an Arab religion, it's for all of mankind. However, somebody has to give da'wah in the very beginning, and the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam gave da'wah to his people. So after that, Islam starts to spread and people enter into al-Islam. When they enter into Islam, they start to speak Arabic. They're starting to speak the Arabic language, because the Muslims, they had a no-nonsense policy when it came to speaking Arabic, which is good, wallahi, because the victor decides how things are going to happen. The person in control, he decides how things are going to happen. So for example, in a marriage, the person, and I'm not talking about oppression, I'm not talking about oppressing a person, but the man is supposed to be the one who has the final say. So as a husband, you should speak to your wife on umur. You should consult her. You should consult. It shouldn't be a dictatorship, but you should consult your wife and tell her and things like that. But you as the man, you have the final say. You are the one that, you are running the show in terms of, you're the person that has the final say. You have the executive decision. So even right now, when it comes to warfare, if a country defeats another country, the country you defeat, the victor, he gets to decide if he's going to let you free, if he's going to take your resources, he decides. So likewise, when the Muslim and Islam spread, the Muslims had the choice. And what they did was they just spoke their language. They didn't force it on other people, learn Arabic. They just spoke their language. And because these people entered into Islam and were amazed at what they saw from the Muslims, they decided to speak the Arabic language. But the Arabic language being very complicated at the time, they started to have something known as al-lahan. And lahan is to make, is to sometimes get something wrong in your statement. So rather than say, like for example right now, if a person ever hears an Arab person speak, he will hear someone say, kayfa halak. But the Arabs of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam time, they'll never say kayfa halak. If you ever say kayfa halak, they would rebuke you. They'll say it's not kayfa halak, it's kayfa haluka. Kayfa haluk. It's not halak, it's haluk. They will not allow that. It's known as lahan, to get something wrong. And they hated that. That was something that was despised. They did not like hearing Arabic that wasn't spoken properly. Which is why they say, اللحن في الكلام أقبح من الجدري في الوجه. To make a mistake in Arabic is worse than having leprosy in your face. They just hate it so much. So people are now starting to enter al-Islam. and people are speaking Arabic differently, and it's only natural, it's a natural occurrence, it's not a bad thing, it's just something that occurred, that people are now starting to speak Arabic, their parents are not Arab, they're just hearing it, they might have not studied it, so they're just trying to learn it the best way they can, and mistakes are forming in the Arabic language, in terms of the way it was spoken in the time of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Basically colloquial kind of forms of Arabic, which are not the same as the original Arabic, are starting to form. Even though languages evolve naturally, so it was never going to stay as Fusha in the first place, but that's a whole other issue, we'll get to that another day, inshallah ta'ala. And the Arabs themselves are starting to change the way they speak. They're starting themselves to not even speak the same. That's why nobody speaks the Quranic Arabic anymore. Because of that, Imam Shafi'i went to go and live in the Badiyah. He went to go and live with the Bedouins. He wanted to hear them. They were the remnants of those people who still spoke Arabiya Fasiha, very good Arabic. And even when you probably compare it to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam's time, you probably can't even compare it. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam's time is still probably much better than Hudayl 100 and something, 150 years or 120 years later. However, they were considered a gold standard at the time. So he goes and he lives with them, he memorizes, he memorizes Ahadith of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but he memorizes the Arabic language in terms of the words, the saying, the phrases, the idioms and things like that. And he spends a long time there. So now maybe he leaves now in his late teens and he wants to go and study ilm. So he's now moved from Gaza, maybe where he grew up for the first primary years of his life, went to go and memorize the Quran, and then stayed with the Hudayl tribe. Okay, he leaves he leaves the Hudayl tribe, and he's now memorized the Quran. He's memorized a large part of ahadith of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he now goes to Mecca searching for knowledge, and he goes to Mecca. And طلب الشافعي العلم بمكة وبلغ شأنا عظيما حتى لقد أذن له بالفتية مسلم ابن خالد الزنجي حيث قال له افتي يا أبا عبد الله فقد آن لك أن تفتي. He went to Mecca, stayed there for a few years, studied with the scholars of Mecca, and يعني بلغ شأنا عظيما يعني, like I said to you before, he was very very bright. And what it may take a person 10 years to study and perfect, it may take another person 2 or 3 years to do the same thing. So he goes to Mecca, studies with the ulama of Mecca, and يعني, people are starting to turn their face and notice him. يعني, this man is, يعني, you know, he's very clever, he's very smart, he's studying well, he understands the Sharia well, he's memorized ahadith, he's memorized the Quran, he understands ahkam, he understands ahadith, he understands fiqh. So, like I said, يعني, طلب العلم بمكة, he goes to seek knowledge in Mecca, and it got to the point where one of the alam of Mecca, one of the great scholars of Mecca, whose name is Muslim ibn Khalid al-Zanji, who said to him, Ifti ya Abdullah, ya Aba Abdullah, give fatwa, O Shafi, O Abu Abdullah, give fatwa. Okay, because it's a time, you've reached the level of giving a fatwa, and it was a young man at the time, okay? And he said, it's the time for you to give fatwa. This alim's name was Muslim ibn Khalid al-Zanji. This word Zanji, it was a traditional, it was an old name that they would call people that were of African descent. Zanj, like a dark-skinned person. But you don't find the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam calling a dark person Zanj. He just said Aswad, someone that's dark. Africa itself, they used to call it, the Muslims of West Africa to Sudan, that was known as Bilad al-Sudan. So every Muslim from West Africa, prior to these new names, Benin, Togo, Kaza, yani the names that don't mean anything in the first place, before it was known as Bilad al-Sudan, because the country, we didn't have countries, nation states. The only country that kept the name Sudan is the country Sudan. But all of us, we were used to call ourselves Ahlu Sudan. The only country that kept themselves Sudan is the country itself Sudan, because the word Sudan is the plural for the word Aswad. It means like land of the blacks kind of thing. And it's not a racial term. It's not racially like, it's not loaded. Now we're looking at it from a different prospect. After the transatlantic slave trade, after this, it's become loaded. But this is 1,000 years before any of that happened. So it wasn't seen as someone that's dark is like this, or someone that's like, it wasn't seen like that. So this person, okay, Muslim Ibn Khalid Zenjihi, they say that he was a black man, or a person of African descent. And that was the case in Mecca. In Mecca and Medina, there was a lot of dark people from African descent. Even one time I was driving in Mecca, I took the wrong turn. I thought I was in LA because, subhanAllah, I saw a house party going on. And we got inside the car, we locked the door, and I said, "Ya Allah, let's just get out of here safe." Okay, and then a little boy started speaking to me in an African language in Mecca. And you know what I'm saying? But that's a whole other thing. He tried to sell me some water, you know. So, and that was just a wrong turn. That was 5 minutes away from the Haram. That wasn't even, I didn't drive far out. I tried to go to Maktabat al-Rush, not Maktabat al-Rush. I tried to go to Aziziya. I took a left turn. Akhi, I'm talking, they were on their cars like it was LA, like, you know, like a sunny strip on their like low riders. I said, SubhanAllah, yani. We're everywhere. Ala kulli hal. Yani, so, but then some ulama, they say no. Muslim Ibn Khalid Zinji wasn't dark. In fact, he was so white, but he used to like dates, they said, Zinji. So they just, yani, play on words, maybe, you know, nicknames that, the way, yani, people now, we have nicknames, maybe a person likes peanut butter or something, you call him peanut butter, or just something like that. Just like that, yani, the ulama, they have looked, they have softness with one another. So some say he was dark, some say no, he was very light, and he was so light, we called him dark. Yani, just playing games and things like that. So anyway, they said to Imam al-Shafi'i, listen, give fatwa. You're at a time where you can give fatawa. Imam Shafi'i didn't. He knew that he was of this level, still being a young man, but he wanted even more knowledge. And like I said to you before, Imam Shafi'i, even though we're going to discuss one particular, we're going to focus on one kind of part, one branch of knowledge that he really is known for, he was also a scholar of hadith, in terms of he knew hadith very well, memorized a lot of hadith. So Imam Shafi'i is in Mecca, he studied in Mecca, he spent some years in Mecca, and they've said to him, Shafi'i, give fatawa, teach the people. But he wants even more knowledge, and he hears about a scholar in Al-Madinah, and his name is Imam Malik. And we talked about Imam Malik last week. And he hears about Imam Malik, and he has with him the Muwatta of Imam Malik, the book of Hadith and book of Athar from the companions of the Tabi'een and Fiqhan. Yeah, and it was a little bit of everything, as we said. And he has that book, Al Muwatta, by Imam Malik. And he hears about it, and he wants to go to Al-Madinah and study with Imam Malik, okay? However, he doesn't just want to go to Imam Malik and say, I want to study with you. And look at this, even in this, there's a fa'id that we can learn as a student of knowledge, or for those who want to be a talib al-ilm. When he goes to Malik, or when he wants to travel to Malik, he doesn't just go and just turn up at the door. Before he goes to Malik, he borrows a book, he borrows the Muwatta. He doesn't have money. Remember, we still said Imam Shafi'i is poor. He borrows a Muwatta from some other talib al-ilm in Mecca. And he memorizes it. Or they say that he goes through it inside out. Some reports say that he memorizes it, but he goes through the book inside out. And like I said, he was very, very smart. He had a very strong mind. So he's looking at it, he's analyzing it. So that when the Shaykh, when he goes to study with Imam Malik, and he's not just going to be thrown off. He's going to know what the book contains. So he goes to Al-Madinah. He travels to Al-Madinah. And he has with him this book, the Muwatta of Imam Malik. And he goes to Imam Malik's study circle in the Masjid of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's masjid. And Imam Malik obviously notices him, notices that he studied my book. He memorized a hadith that I put into the book. So he starts to notice this young man, Shafi'i, you know. And obviously Shafi'i has come from Mecca. And he's a newcomer in town. And the tabi'ah, the way the ulama of the past used to be, was that if someone came from far, from their balad, they had more ihtiram for them. If someone came from far, then, they would have more kind of يعني, respect for that person because he's come all the way from far. I have to يعني, give him some extra care because he's not from this. He's not from this place. And he didn't just come from Mecca. He wasn't born in Mecca. Remember, he was born in Gaza. So he went all the way from Gaza to Mecca, now to Al-Madinah. He's still a young man. So he goes to Imam Malik, starts in Imam Malik's circle, and Imam Malik starts to take a liking to this young sheikh or this young talib al-ilm who was a mufti already at that age already. And he takes a liking to him. Now why did Imam Malik take a liking to Imam al-Shafi'i? Number one, maybe he was already a mufti. He's already someone that's a talib al-ilm. So he's not just someone who's coming, he doesn't know what he's even getting himself into, and he says, I want to go, Sheikh, I want to study with you. He's come with the prerequisites. He's come with the prerequisites, okay? And he's come. He's already memorized a hadith of the Muwatta of Imam Malik. Not only that, when he read the Muwatta of Imam Malik, he read it beautifully, meaning he didn't make grammatical mistakes in his Arabic. And we just said that he spent 10 years with the Bedouins learning sharpening his linguistic skills. So the ulama, for example, or the sheikh that I got this book, they're saying, you know, one of the maybe one of the reasons why Imam Malik took a liking to him was husnu qira'atihi, the fact that he read very well, wa i'rabihi, he said everything, he gave every haraka he made, he said every haraka correctly. He didn't say anin nabiyya, he said anin nabiyyi, you know, he didn't make it mansub, he made it marfu', yani things that yani if you study Arabic yani you learn. And then it got to the point where when يعني, he was reading it so much, when he was studying with him and reading the Muwatta of Imam Malik, يعني, Imam Malik said, "Ya fatan zid, oh young man, carry on." يعني, he was loving it. You know, they say in English, and it's not literal, but it's in English, like, when something's like music to your ears, يعني, you're reading it so beautifully, so eloquently, you're not making one mistake. He said, "Ya fatan zid, oh young man, carry on reading this." And then Shafi'i said about this, ثم قال شافعي حتى قرأته عليه في أيام يسيرة. I read it to him, I read the Muwatta of Imam Malik to him, and I finished it in just a few days. We finished it, he enjoyed it so much, I just read the whole entire book to him in a few days. يعني, and obviously they carried on studying, but that was just reading the Muwatta. So that's maybe one of the things that يعني, made Shafi'i, yeah, and that's one of the things that possibly made Imam Malik, you know, give a special, يعني, kind of care to Imam Shafi'i. And then you know, لزم الشافعي مالك ويدارسه ويناقشه ويتعلم من. يعني after that, Shafi'i stayed with Malik. Okay, يدارسه. So he studied with him, but it wasn't just studying. It was Mudarasa is like to study and to it's like a give and take, to kind of there's words, you guys know, you know, maybe you guys can help with the words when you're studying with someone, but you're not just studying, you're posing questions back and forth. I forgot the word in English. What's the word when you're interacting and like you're bouncing off of one another. Collaborating, but like there's a word, I forgot what it is, but when you're bouncing off of one another, each other's energy, and you're studying, and you're, you know, it's not like a kind of I'm the sheikh, you're the student kind of relationship. It is like that, but it's you're able to ask and you're able to pose questions, he asks back, you're able to study. It's not just simply قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. You're doing مدارسة, you're studying together, and at the same time you're revising together, and at the same time you're discourse. They engage in scholarly discourse. Aywa. Scholarly discourse, okay? They were engaging in scholarly discourse. So that happened for a few years until Imam Malik died in the year 179 of the Hijrah. So So يعني, so Shafi'i stayed with Malik up until he died. Up until he died. Now, what's apparent, as some of the biographers of Imam Shafi'i, they say that Imam Shafi'i, he would study with Malik. وَلَزِمَ مَالِكُ was with him, wouldn't leave him. But there were maybe certain times where Imam Shafi'i maybe had to travel. Maybe he had some needs or things like that. So he was studying with Malik. Perhaps he maybe استأذن من, he maybe sought permission. Yeah, you know, yeah, Imam, I have to maybe go and do something. I'll be back in 1 month's time. And he would travel around the Muslim world, okay? وَيَسْتَفِيدُ مِنْ أَحْوَالِ النَّاسِ. While he was studying with Malik, and maybe he had his own personal needs he had to tend to, and he would maybe travel to different places, maybe at the same time, maybe take a hadith from one sheikh or study from another sheikh quickly, maybe, you know, do some work to maybe gain some money so he can come back and fund his fund his studies, because at this time nobody's funding him and he still doesn't have any money, doesn't have, you know, what you would call a job or an income or anything like that. يعني, in his travels, يَسْتَفِيدُ مِنْ أَحْوَالِ النَّاسِ. If you look at يعني, the four a'immah, I would say يعني, the one who's probably travelled extensively, I know you have Imam Ahmad, but Imam Shafi'i's travelled extensively. And one of the benefits of travelling is that you learn from other people. You learn from other people. You don't just stay in your own falak, in your own kind of little kind of solar system, your own little kind of motion of orbit. You just stick with yourself, you don't know anything about anybody else. As a Muslim, you should want to know about other people. You shouldn't just think about my people, my country, my qawm. You should want to read about other people. There's other Muslims. There's Muslims in the East. There's Muslims in the West. There's Muslims in South America. There's Muslims here. There's Muslim there. Read a bit about them. Read even on Wikipedia a bit about Muslims in different countries. Have thaqafa. Learn about different people so that if you meet them, you don't just clash. You know about them. You know that in this person's culture, if you do this, it's considered rude. If you speak to this person, maybe you can say this. And then sometimes that can create a better understanding. As for now, every Muslim doesn't know nothing about another person, and after you meet the Muslim, says, brother, when did you take your shahada? Because he doesn't even know that يعني, your whole country is Muslim and your people are Muslim before his people are Muslim, and he's asking you, when did you take your shahada? That's an ignorance, ya akhi al-kareem. That is absolute ignorance. So, as Muslims, we need to know about one another. And in those times, the Muslim Ummah didn't have borders, so people would know about one another. And perhaps this is one of the things that made Imam Shafi'i so unique and so clever, that he's a linguist, he is very smart, he's memorized a hadith, and he's mixed with people. When you mix with people, when you interact with different people, يعني, your ability to judge, your ability to look into the ahwal of people, your ability to look at different situations and not look at things at a surface level, it begins to increase. It begins to become, يعني, you don't just see the things through your nation, your people, your village, or something like that. You have, يعني, you've broadened your horizon. So at this time, Imam al-Shafi'i is broadening his horizons, and look at the irony in that. At the same time, he's Qurashi, he's from Quraysh. He could have just been like, I'm from the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, family, assalamu alaikum, give me money, kaza, kaza, kaza. He didn't do that. He went around and he traveled, and he looked, and he learnt, okay? He learnt before he spoke. So, يعني, Imam Malik dies, okay? And Imam Shafi'i at this time was already a scholar. He was a scholar before he met Imam Malik, like we said. So only by great analogy is going to be an even greater scholar. Imam Shafi'i at this time, he, after the death of Imam Malik in 179, he says to himself that, you know, he needs to make some kind of money. Yeah, and he's getting to an age where, you know, he can't keep living like this. He has to, yeah, eventually fend for himself. You can't keep doing the, you know, you can't live like you're 18, 19 all your life, you know, where you're living on scraps and, you know, you just, you know, يعني, the way we were in the jam'ah, you know, I got to a point where I got to the jam'ah, I was 21 years old, I could do it, you know, the indomie, the noodles, I got to a point, I'm 26, 27, like, I can't do this no more. Allah, I can't do it no more, like, I need to have a car, I need to have a house, I can't live like that, I'm not 18. You have the mashallah, the 18-year-old brothers, they come to Al-Madinah, everyone, six people in a room, and everyone, mashallah, man's high. I got to a point, I'm a big man, I'm I can't do this, akhi. You know what I'm saying? This one doing this, this one, kada, this one breaking his wudu in the room stinks. And you can't, you know, I'm just trying to say that you can't live like that. Maybe some of you are young and you think you can do it, you can't live like that. Even maybe some of you now, mashallah, you're maybe going to college or university with only 3 hours sleep. You're going to get to an age where, wallahi, you need 8 hours of sleep. You can't even function, maybe about 6-7 hours of sleep, okay? Yani, your age, yani, you begin to age hard to get older, you can't do the same thing. So, had the Imam Shafi, yani, he needs some fulus now. He needs some fulus. He can't, yani, you know. So, even him, and it's natural. Don't fight it when that thing comes to you. You don't fight it. It's natural, ya akhil kareem. You get to an age where maybe you want to get married, maybe you want to start a family. So, you have to do that which necessitates that. And you can't do that with the mentality or the lifestyle of an 18-year-old, you know, maybe playing Xbox or something like that. Things change, you know, things. I used to love those days, you know, wallahi, I love those days, you know, playing, you know, computer games and not worrying about anything. But actually, we have to get older in life. So, Imam Shafi'i, you know, he grows up and mashallah, he's a young man, and he wants to maybe just gain some money, not to become rich, yani liyasuddu hajatuh. Yani, so he can, yani, just, he doesn't have to ask people for anything. I never used to ask in the first place, but so he can just have that, yani, that pride of ownership, as they say. So he goes to Najran. He travels to Najran, and in the city of Najran, they find out that he's from the, and this is right after the death of Imam Shafi'i. So the year 170, 169 to 170, 172. So he goes to Najran, and they find out that he is from the, you know, the family of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in terms of his tribal lineage, and they realize that he has a lot of knowledge. So they say, you know, okay, why don't you work with us, yani, why don't you, يعني, become a judge with us, and, you know, judge the people, judge maybe issues regarding the marketplace and things like that, and inshallah you can receive some sort of stipend or something. So Imam Shafi'i took that position, and he worked as a judge in Najran. He worked as a judge in Najran, and يعني, he also went to Al-Yemen. Now in Najran, يعني, people started to really, mashallah, the people became, يعني, he became beloved to the people in Najran. He wasn't really teaching there, but his judgments were, يعني, as they say, فصل القضاء, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam spoke about, يعني, فصل القضاء, يعني, he was very, very, very good in his judgment, very precise, very fair, very just. So the people of Najran didn't have to pay him bribes as they did with other judges or other kind of administrators or officials, government officials. Didn't have to do any of the things that people have to do to kind of get by. He was fair, very just. He then moves to Al-Yemen and does the same thing. When he's in Yemen, like I said, Imam Abu Hanifa, Imam Malik, Imam Ahmed, Imam Shafi'i, they lived in times when the Islamic Khilafah was going through different phases. So we spoke about the time of Imam Abu Hanifa, how he grew up in the time of the Umayyads. And we haven't got time to speak about that now, but they're called in English the Umayyads. You can read about them, Banu Umayyah. When Banu Umayyah, who are a branch of Quraysh, got taken over by the Abbasis, and the Abbasis are another branch of Quraysh, who are closer to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in lineage, and felt as if they had more right to rule. Obviously, the Umayyads were kicked out, and the Umayyad kind of dynasty was not even 150, 160 years, or maybe even less than that. So Imam Shafi'i is living in Yemen, and the Umayyads are gone, and the Abbasids are there, and yani, like I said to you before, the fact that he's Qurashi, they might believe that maybe he has particular political allegiances to somebody, and he doesn't. He's just an alim. He's not involved in politics, but because they've heard, oh, this man, he's Qurashi, okay, he's Qurashi, and yani, they think that perhaps him being from his lineage, maybe he's going to maybe do something and try to maybe bring down certain political entities in Yemen or something. Yani, they had like a question mark over this man. Why is he here? And he was arrested. He was arrested with a group of 9 other people, and yani, he was facing execution. Reports state that those 8 people were all executed, and Imam Shafi'i survived.
And only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. But what we do know is that he was facing some kind of problems in Yemen. When he went to Yemen, like I said, he was saved. Now, some of the ulama, they say that he was saved for two reasons. Well, number one, his ilm, his knowledge. Meaning that when he was actually in front of the court of law, he was asking the judge and the emir who was looking over the case, he was asking him questions and outsmarting the emir. And the emir felt like, yani, he felt unintelligent. He felt, subhanAllah, how is this man? He's so intelligent. Why would an intelligent man like this want to get into something as dirty and filthy like siyasa, like politics? Why? So he thought, okay. The second thing is, a letter from Muhammad ibn Hassan al-Shaybani from Iraq. He heard about the fact that Imam Shafi'i was locked up. Okay, and at this time he's not known as the great Imam Shafi'i, but he's still known in the circles of knowledge. Muhammad ibn Hassan al-Shaybani was the student of Imam Abu Hanifa that we spoke about in the Abu Hanifa lecture. Abu Hassan al-Shaybani hears that Imam Shafi'i is locked up, and he writes a letter to the emir that, look, you can't kill this man. This man's innocent. He's got nothing to do with politics. He's not a politician. He doesn't have any allegiances. Let this man go. And alhamdulillah, in the year 184, he's freed, manages to escape from the fitna of Yemen. So like I said to you before, that's 5 years now after the death of Malik. Okay, so he went to Yemen, Najran. He spent about 5 years making a bit of money, you know, working, doing some, maybe you can call it, clerical positions. And he now goes to, and now the 184, and he's 34 years of age. We said that he was born in the year 150. So at age 34, he now goes to Iraq to go and study with the scholars of Iraq. So Imam Shafi'i arrives in Baghdad, and having already studied the fiqh of Imam Malik, which is the fiqh of Ahlul Hadith, he now goes to Iraq, where, like we said before, they are upon the tariqah of Ahl al-Ra'i. And we said that the tariqah of Ahl al-Ra'i is not the tariqah of Ahl al-Hadith. So, just to break it down before, when I say tariqah, I'm saying like the methodology of studying. You had two types of ways of studying Islamic knowledge at the time. You had the tariqah of Ahl al-Hadith, which was the tariqah of the people of Hadith, which was that they wouldn't use analogy, because where they lived was full of ahadith. It was full of ahadith, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, so they wouldn't make scholarly analogies, and they wouldn't use adil al-aqliya. They wouldn't use logic that much. And when I say logic, I'm not talking about ilm al-kalam. I'm not talking about philosophy. I'm saying that they just wouldn't make logical deductions as much, because they had a lot of dalil. In Iraq, as we said, there's a lot of liars in Iraq. So at-tashaddud fi qabool al-hadith, not accepting a hadith, was one of the things that they would do in Iraq, because people lied. We said that there were Christians, we said that there were Shia, we said there was Khawarij, we said that there was Mu'tazila, we said that there was this, that there was that. And because of that, in Iraq, every group is making up a hadith, saying that the Prophet said this to support their cause. That's what they were doing. So the scholars of the Sunnah there said, listen, we can't take a hadith, because it was simply too dangerous. If we build our hadith upon what this Mu'tazili is saying, or what this Shi'i is saying, or what this person, this Qadri, or whatever is saying, then we can build something which is incorrect. So what they did was, they took the fatawa that they had from some of the companions, Abdullah bin Mas'ud, and when new issues would arise, they would look at that fatawa and they'll try to make an analogy from these fatawa and these ayat that they had. So they were using a lot of analogy, and because they were using a lot of analogy, their analytical skills were stronger than the people of Ahlul Hadith. So the people of Ahlul Hadith had dalil, they didn't need to make analogy. The people of Iraq, they didn't have a hadith, but they had strong analytical skills. So they were able to critique the Quran, Sunnah, and the fatwa of the Sahabas in a way that these other scholars couldn't. They developed a way of interpreting the Sharia. Now, they weren't just interpreting the Sharia off of nothing. They were interpreting it from the fatwa of other Sahabas who were there previously. They didn't just make things up. So that's very important for us to understand. So some of what they did was right, some of what they did was wrong. There are certain things that they did which were not wrong, like istihsan and things like that, that other things that Imam, there was some certain kind of scholarly principles that they had, certain legal principles that they had, that Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, the Jamhur, the majority of the scholars of Usul al-Fiqh, they don't generally speaking take them. Something like, for example, the mas'ala of istihsan. When there's nothing, when there's no dalil for something, can we say it's good or bad based on what it appears to be? Imam Abu Hanifa would do something known as istihsan. If something wasn't halal or haram and it seemed to be okay, he would say this is hasan, this is good. You're playing a dangerous game, but they had to do it because they had nothing else. They didn't have a hadith, they didn't have hundreds of and thousands of ahadith. Whereas in Medina, Mecca, they would never used to do qiyas. They wouldn't make analogy because there's hundreds and thousands of ahadith. So every new thing that happens, if there's a difference in the market, if there's something that's happening, they have a hadith. Assalamu alaikum, it's right there. Iraq didn't have that. So Imam Shafi'i studying with Imam Malik and studying from the tariqah, from the way of Ahlul Hadith, they don't use a lot of analogy. He's now studying with the Iraqis, he's now studying with Ahlul Iraq. Okay, and he's now studying with the students of Abu Hanifa. Abu Hanifa died the year Imam Shafi'i was born, 150. So he can't meet Imam Shafi'i, but he meets his students. He meets the student of Imam Abu Hanifa. Now, he doesn't go there as like a student studying from zero. He's a scholar in his own right. So the way in which he's obviously going to study this is like comparative study. He's going to be studying it based on what he has already learned. He's not going to be starting from zero and he's just going to soak up everything they say. He's going to be able to obviously critically analyze what they are giving him. So he goes there and he takes from Ahlul Ra'i, and obviously he takes from what they do. And يعني تعلم الفقه الذي يغلب عليه النقل والفقه الذي يغلب عليه العقل. He had learned fiqh that was based upon dalil in majority, and he also learned in his time in Iraq from fiqh that had a lot of a logical analysis. So يعني when he did this he was able to mix the two طرق. He was able to mix the two طرق. He was able to mix the two paths that were being done at that particular time. So he's not someone that was raised in Medina and only knew about the fiqh of Ahlul Medina, and he wasn't someone that was raised in Iraq and took from Ahlul Iraq. He was able to look at things differently, which is why Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, the great scholar of hadith, who a lot of the imma said with Ibn Hajar, salamu alaykum, ilm al-hadith intaha. With Ibn Hajar, the knowledge of ilm al-hadith is finished. That's what they used to say. Imam Ibn Hajar, he's the end of ilm al-hadith, meaning that, khalas, al-hadith, al-ahadith mudawwana, العلوم أو مصطلح الحديث مدونة يعني the hadith has been now written, the how to know hadith terminology is there, how to know who's sahih and who's not is has been categorized, and with Ibn Hajar salamu alaykum the issue is over. That's what they used to say, not saying that there can't be other scholars of ahadith. They were trying to say that Ibn Hajar was such a great scholar of hadith. After him, it's very difficult to say that somebody after Ibn Hajar can do a better job than him. That's what they argue. Even the scholars that come after him, Sakhawi, Suyuti, they can't do what Ibn Hajar did. Which is why the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, when he entered Mecca, what did he say? The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he said, لا هجرة بعد الفتح ولكن جهاد ونية. He said, there's no hijrah after the conquest of Mecca. The conquest of Mecca, when the Muslims will enter Mecca victorious, is known as Fathu Mecca, the conquest of Mecca. So the Prophet said, after this conquest, this Fath, there's no hijrah. لا هجرة لا هجرة بعد الفتح. Imam Ibn Hajar, the guy that I was just speaking about just now, he has a book which is an explanation of Sahih al-Bukhari known as Fathul Bari, بشرح Sahih al-Bukhari. Imam Shawkani, when speaking about it, he said, لا هجرة بعد الفتح. Like, yeah, playing on words, because Fath al-Bari said that there's no other book to go to in terms of the, even though there's hundreds of explanations of Bukhari, he said, La hijrata ba'd al-Fath. After Imam Ibn Hajar wrote Fath al-Bari,
there's no need now to go to anything else. It's kamil, shamil, it contains everything. There's no need to go to any other thing. But even with Imam Shawkani, he took the topic, he took the name titles and took a lot of things from Imam Ibn Suyuti and took a lot of the name titles. But that's a whole other thing we'll find. One talib al-ilm told me that in Saudi, I did my own investigation, where he'll say it was sahih. But that's a whole other issue. We'll get to that another day, inshallah ta'ala. Anyway, Ibn Hajar goes on to say, he says something about Imam Shafi'i and his manaqib. Wallahi, Imam Shafi'i was incredible. Imam Shafi'i was incredible. Wallahi, if you ask me which one would I want to meet, me being from where I'm from, my qalb is telling me Imam Malik, because I'm with Maliki, historically. But my aql is telling me Imam Shafi'i. I'm just talking about in terms of ilm. Obviously, if we had the chance, we'll all meet the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, of course, and the Sahaba. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to enter al-Jannah with them. Anyway, Imam Ibn Hajar goes on to say, and Imam Ibn Hajar was known to tell jokes. He was the best Sahih Bukhari, and he was known to be someone that he used to like to laugh and tell jokes. So the brothers who like to be, I'm depressed, I'm practicing Islam, and I'm depressed, and I have no friends, that's not from al-Islam. Ibn Daqiq al-Eid, scholar of hadith, used to not say anything. Ibn Taymiyyah would talk. Yani person would like to talk. So some brothers who think that yani you can't say anything, you can't even smile, that's not from al-Islam. That's your own yani something. لا بد من معالجته. You have to cure that yourself. It's not from Islam to have yani, I'm miserable yani. That's not from al-Islam. A lot of people, they think that when it's up to Islam, it's not from Islam at all. Let's stay on topic, inshallah. I have the ability to rant. Let's stay on topic. So Imam Ibn Hajar goes on to say, انتهت الرئاسة الفقه بالمدينة إلى مالك. The head of fiqh, يعني the very essence, the zenith of fiqh in Medina was with Malik. Okay. Malik ibn Anas. فرحل إليه ولازمه وأخذ عنه. And Shafi'i went to that zenith and took from that peak of the mountain. And then he said, وانتهت رياسة الفقه بالعراق إلى أبي حنيفة فأخذ عن صاحبه. And the pinnacle of fiqh in Iraq was Abu Hanifa, and Imam Shafi'i went to the pinnacle and he couldn't take from Abu Hanifa, so he took from his student, okay, who was Muhammad al-Shaybani. فاجتمع علم أهل الرأي وعلم أهل الحديث. He was able to combine between the ilm of Iraq and the ilm of Ahl Medina. فتصرف في ذلك. And he was able to form something that both sides could agree on, because at that point the two sides couldn't agree. And that's another issue maybe we can speak about, that the wars between the Shafi'iyya and the Ahnaf back in the day, people don't know about that. The Ahnaf and the Shafi'is, they never used to get along. In a country that's no longer Sunni. Where was it? It was Iran. Iran was Shafi'i and Hanafi, but predominantly Shafi'i for almost 900 years. This thing that we think that Iran is a Shafi'i, it was Shafi'i, it became a Shi'i when the Safawiyyah, the Safavids took over. That's another thing we need to speak about. The Sunni Islam was in Iran for 900 years. The greatest scholars of Shafi'i fiqh, many of them, before Egypt, it was Iran. That's why he said Imam al-Shirazi, al-Shirazi, Imam al-Razi, Imam al-Marwazi. Whenever you hear this thing, al-Razi, al-Razi, just how many Imam al-Razi? You hear maybe Fakhruddin al-Razi, kada kada al-Razi, Abu Hatim al-Razi. Some of them obviously the Aqidah is an issue, but Imam al-Razi, who wrote the dictionaries, Mukhtar al-Siha, al-Razi. Raz, or Imam al-Marwazi. This place, Razi, is the capital of it's Tehran now, what they call Tehran. It's a sub-district, it's a district of Tehran. And it used to be known as al-Raz. And how many imam, maybe because bring hundreds of scholars that say they're from al-Razi, or al-Raz, okay, or al-Hamadan. Or places like that. There were so many places previously where the Ahnaf and the Shafi'iyya, or where the Shafi'iyya used to dominate. They're no longer there anymore, you know. So he was able to combine, as Imam Ibn Hajar says. وقعد القواعد, and he said, no, he said وأصل الأصول. He was able to bring principles. وقعد القواعد. He was able to create legal maxims. Okay. وأذعن له الموافق والمخالف. After Shafi'i did all of that,
أذعن له الموافق والمخالف. Even the person who agreed with him had to say he's the best. He had to admit it. And the person who hated Shafi'i, whether he loved it or hated him, he had to say, this man, he's come, he's an imam, and he's come with something that nobody has done before. Okay? وَصَارَ مِنْهُ مَا صَارَ. And he became what he became. So Shafi'i stays in Baghdad and studies under Imam Ibn al-Hasan. Okay, debating his students, studying. And Imam Ibn al-Hasan, okay, would say to Imam Shafi'i, you know, teach us, tell us, because they had never met somebody who was from Ahl al-Hadith, but was so strong in his language, so strong in his mental capacity, so strong in his ability to deduct, scholarly kind of analysis. And subhanAllah, he used to say, stand up and teach us and debate with us. And they're talking about debating in a good way. Let's have positive, let's have munaqashat ilmiya, let's have knowledge-based debates and discourse. Let's bounce off of one another and go back and forth. And he would do that. And subhanAllah, this was a beautiful time for Imam al-Shafi'i. And it wasn't too long till he left Iraq again. And biographers of Imam Shafi'i say that there's no time, there's no precise time as to how long he stayed in Iraq. We don't know, but biographers determine that it must have been at the very least 2 years, because you can't study and do munaqasha and debate with people with their own madhab unless you stay there for some time. So some ulama say it must have been ala al-aqal 2 years, okay? It must have been 2 years. Then Shafi'i went to Mecca. أخذ يلقي دروسه في الحرم المكي والتقى به أكبر العلماء في موسم الحج. Imam Shafi'i then goes to Mecca, lives in Mecca for around 9 years, teaches in the Haram, so Masjid al-Haram in Mecca. And all of the ulama or the great scholars of that time come to meet him. And when they'll come to meet him, they'll meet him in Hajj. Because before, there was no kind of boundaries, or you could just travel to Hajj. If you just had the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, azad wa rahila, if you just have like a donkey and enough money to go to Hajj, you can just go. So the scholars, in the time of the scholars, in the early, just early, 500, 600, 700, 800, 900 years, even up to like 1,000, up till about 400, 500 years ago, even 300 years ago, the meeting place for scholars to meet up was from Hajj. So maybe a scholar from Africa read the book from a scholar of Damascus, and the scholar of Damascus read the book from a scholar of India and Persia and here and there. And if they wanted to debate or meet with one another and discuss, there was no telephone, you had to meet in Hajj. Hajj was where people would meet. So when he was teaching these classes, he was teaching in Mecca for around 9 years. This is where another great imam learns about this great alim, and sitting in those durus was Shaykh Ahmed ibn Hanbal, who we will study insha'Allah ta'ala next week. Imam Shafi'i teaches in Mecca, like I said, for 9 years, and at this time he starts to think about, maybe it's time to author a book. Maybe you should author a book or author something that combines the madrasa of Ahlul Ra'i and the madrasa of Ahlul Hadith. He then goes back in the year 195 to Iraq. He goes back to Iraq again. So now he's gone from Mecca, lived Mecca for 9 years, was in Iraq 2 years, Mecca 9 years, so 11 years. And now after 11 years of first arrived in Iraq, he returns back to Iraq in the year 195. He goes, and at this time he's asked by, when he goes back to Iraq, he's teaching obviously, and a Sheikh of Hadith known as Abdul Rahman ibn Mahdi. The Shaykh, the Alim, Abdul Rahman ibn Mahdi, comes to Imam Shafi'i. And he comes to Imam Shafi'i and he asks him a question. Himself being a scholar of hadith, he asks Imam Shafi'i, can you combine for us a book that we're able to interpret the Sharia with this book? Because like I said to you before, people were interpreting the Sharia before, but everything was mutashattit. Everything was a bit here, a bit there, because everything was spread. So Abdurrahman ibn Mahdi saying, look, Imam Shafi'i, you have knowledge. You study with Malik, you study in Medina, you study with the student Imam of Imam Abu Hanifa, and he studied with many other great scholars, not just those two. He had hundreds of scholars, but we can't get into all of them in one small class. So the scholar of hadith, Abdurrahman ibn Mahdi, is going to Imam Shafi'i, who's a scholar of fiqh and also knows hadith, but is a scholar of hadith, and says, listen, give us something that we can use as a framework to implement and understand and deduct rulings from all of these ahadith and ayat of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So in the book Manaqib al-Shafi'i, he reports Abdurrahman that waruwiya anna Abdurrahman ibn Mahdi iltamasa min Shafi'i wa huwa shab. Yani he asks Shafi'i, iltamasa minhu, he makes like a request, please, يعني, iltimas, please, if you don't mind. And he himself was a young man. يعني, you know, to write a book, and يَضَعَ لَهُ كِتَابًا يَذْكُرُ فِيهِ شَرَائِطُ الْإِسْتِدْلَالِ. He asked Shafi'i to write a book that has within it the conditions of how to extract a ruling. So the way, for example, yesterday, whoever was here, Sheikh Abdul Wahid went through Al-Usul min Ilm al-Usul, a small little book showing the evidences of Usul al-Fiqh. Usul al-fiqh. So this person is basically asking him to write for us, how do we extrapolate evidences? When Allah says an ayah, how do we know if the ayah is wajib? How do we know if something's sunnah? How do we know something's mustahab? How do we know if this particular thing relates to everybody or relates to something, to something which is only specific to a few? How can we interpret these ayat, okay? And then after he says, التمس من شافعي أن يضع له كتابا يذكر فيه شرائط الاستدلال بالقرآن والسنة. Give us a book that we can learn how to extrapolate rules from the Quran and the Sunnah. والإجماع. Tell us how we know something has إجماع. How do we know when there's scholarly consensus in something? What are the criteria for ijma? Whose ijma do we take? Whose ijma do we not take? Does ijma exist in the first place? He's asking us, give us something that we can understand. Wal qiyas, an analogy. Are we allowed to make analogy in the sharia? What constitutes as an analogy? How do we make an analogy? What do we make an analogy with? And things like that. How do we do it? You know, and obviously, an analogy, qiyas, the most important thing of qiyas is obviously something in usul al-fiqh known as al-illa, al-illa. So qiyas is what do you call it? Radd al-far' ala al-asl, or radd al-far'i ala al-asli bi'illatin jami'atin baynahuma. He's asking, how do we make qiyas? How do we get an original ruling in the Quran and apply it to something new that's happened? So for example, a person someone does something. How would we know the ruling of that thing if it's not found in the Quran and Sunnah? How do we make an analogy? What's the criteria of doing that? So he asked him that. Okay. وَبَيَانُ نَاسِخٍ أو وَبَيَانُ النَّاسِخِ مِنَ الْمَنْسُوخِ. And how do we know the abrogated verses from the non-abrogated verses? Abrogated verses, okay, are ones that they are still ayat of the Quran, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala abrogated their meaning. Their meaning does not exist anymore. How do we know the difference between nasikh and mansukh? Okay. And how do we know? So that he asks him that. And then he says, and also maratibul umum wal khusus. How do we, what are the levels of general ayahs? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, wal asr, innal insana lafi khusrin. Allah says, wal asr, by time, innal insan lafi khusr. Verily, mankind is in loss. Allah says, innal insan, al insan. This al, okay, al muhalla, or lafz al muhalla, bil alifi wal lam. When a word has an alif and lam between it, what does it mean? Is it al istighraqiyya? Is it for every person? Or is it al ahdiyya? Is it for a specific person? What does this al asr, the, what does this the mean? The word the is equivalent in English. Does this the mean that it is for everyone? Does this, because you could say the people, or you can mean meaning everyone, or you can mean the people meaning a specific group of people, or that person right there, or those group of people right there. How do we interpret that? So he's asking them, how do we do that? And what did we just say before? Imam Shafi'i lived with Hudayl tribe. He lived with the Hudayl tribe, who were fasih. The Arabic was very close to the Arabic of the companions. So the way the companions learned the Quran and understood the Arabic language Imam Shafi has a greater understanding of that because he lived 10 years with those people. So Shafi'i, he writes this book, and he names his book Al-Risala. It's a well-known book. It's the first book in Usul al-Fiqh. It's the first ever book written in Usul al-Fiqh known as Al-Risala, the Risala of Imam Shafi'i. He writes his book and he gives it to Abdurrahman ibn Mahdi. Abdurrahman ibn Mahdi opens his book and he says, "Ma adhunnu anna Allah khalaqa mithlu hadha ar-rajul." I didn't know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made a man like this. I couldn't even believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made a man like this. We asked him to do this and he just brought us something that now with yaqeen we can look at the ahkam of the shaykh, we can look at the ruling and we can extrapolate in a way which subhanAllah combines everything that the scholar says and removes those things which are incorrect. So So I don't have COVID like I said. So Imam Shafi'i writes this book. He writes this book and he stays in Iraq for 2 years. Okay, he stays, he leaves Iraq and then he comes back again. Okay, and then he leaves for a final time in the year 199 to Egypt. He leaves in the year 199 to Masr, to go to Egypt. Now, why did Imam Shafi'i leave? That's a very, very good question. Why did Imam Shafi'i leave Iraq when it was the, at that time, it was a place where majority of scholars were? Okay. One of the particular reasons could have been because the Khalifa Ma'mun at that time, Ma'mun, was affected by the Aqidah of the Mu'tazila. And we're going to get to the Mu'tazila. Well, we're not going to get to the Mu'tazila, but we might speak about them in more detail. So the Khalifa at that time, okay, in Iraq, his name was Al-Ma'mun. And he was listening to the Shubuhat or the arguments of the Mu'tazila. Basically, the Mu'tazila were another group that did not believe in the ideas, or not the ideas, they didn't believe the Aqidah of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. And they used to use a lot of logic. So they persuaded this Khalifa Ma'mun to take the Aqidah. And anyone that disagreed with them would have been killed, executed, you know, hung, drawn, and quartered, basically. So one of the possibilities is that Imam Shafi'i wanted to escape the fitna and leave. Okay. Another thing is, when the Abbasids took over, they relied heavily on the Persians. They relied heavily on the Persians and the Persian influence and just politics. He just wanted to leave away some of the internal politics. So then he goes to Egypt. He goes to Egypt, and we're now kind of coming to the end of the life of Imam Shafi'i. Imam Shafi'i didn't live for that long. He only lived for 54 years. He didn't live for that long. He didn't He didn't live like Imam Malik, you know, 87, 88 years. He only lived for 54 years. And he goes to Masr. Now, when it comes to Imam Shafi'i, whoever says his madhab, you know that Yasuf knows Imam Shafi'i fil Qadim and Imam Shafi'i fil Jadid. Everyone knows that Imam Shafi'i's positions divide into two. The old statements of Imam Shafi'i, i.e. when he was in Iraq, and then you have the latter sayings of Imam Shafi'i when he was in Egypt, what he died upon. Some of the stuff, some of his viewpoints, he changed. So some of the stuff that he had, that he said in Iraq, when he looked into the Dalil in the Quran, the Sunnah, and certain masail, some issues of fiqh, he may have looked into it again and changed his mind. He's a scholar, he has the right to change his mind. So you have Al-Imam Shafi'i fil Qadim, we have Imam Shafi'i fil Jadid. Imam Shafi'i fil Qadim is in his time is Iraq, and Imam Shafi'i in the Jadid is the time of, in his time in Egypt. Now, Imam Shafi'i, some of the books that he wrote or are attributed to him, he has a book in Furuq, yani fiqhi kind of issues, one of them known as Al-Hujjah, and he writes that in Iraq, and some of the books that he wrote when he was in Egypt is the book known as Al-Umm, Kitab Al-Umm, you know, Al-Umm. In Arabic, obviously people think it's mother. It can also mean like the heart of something, the very essence of something. Not the essence, that's the wrong word. The all-encompassing thing, the you know. So Allah talks about Ummul Kitab and things like that, you know. So, you know, I can say, for example, Misr Ummu Qira'at al-Qur'an. Misr is the of recital of the Qur'an, meaning that يعني, they are the trailblazers. They are the people who at this current moment, they are the people of يعني, they are the people of the, they are Ahlul Fan, they are the people of this science, they're the people of Quran. So they're like the they are the gold standard. So he wrote this book Al-Umm, okay, in in fiqh. And it was a build, he built it up on what he obviously wrote previously in Al-Hujjah. He also has Al-Amali Al-Kubra, he has Al-Imla Al-Saghir. And some of these books, yeah, it's argued whether or not he wrote them or not, or was it things that were dictated to his students, and we're not going to get into that. Maybe it was a mixture of both. Now, yani just a small thing, al-um. So yeah, a little joke. I remember one sheikh. He said that, yani, you know, some people maybe them, you know, some people don't have ilm. So a person which has to sometimes give da'wah, he may not have ilm. You know, he can give da'wah in that which he can talk about, but obviously he might not be able to speak about things that he doesn't know. So this person, he said, subhanAllah, he said he's trying to. There was a man who's trying to persuade people to be good to their parents, good to their mothers. So he said, the mother is so important in Islam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us to be kitab, tell your mothers. To the point where Imam Shafi'i, he wrote a book, Kitabul Umm, the book about your mother. But Imam Shafi'i didn't mean Umm like that. He meant yani, all encompassing, that particular book that has something which is, if you like, an authority in its field. Ala kulli hal, what we need to understand is that Imam Shafi'i, when he set out to study ilm, he didn't seek out to start his own madhab. And when we say madhab, we're talking about like just a group of people who follow his position. He didn't try to start something where I want you to follow me. He didn't do that. He started out and was, you could even argue he was a Maliki. Okay, but as he grew in knowledge, he began to differ with Imam Malik on certain issues. Not differ with him personally, he just had different opinions. He saw things differently, and it's from his haqq to do that. You know, a person can see something, two people can see something happen and can interpret it in two different ways. So he just didn't agree with certain things, maybe certain things that Imam Malik said in fiqh, and he had knowledge of hadith as well. So he had his own personal opinions. The problem is that when he went to Egypt, Imam Malik's students were in Egypt, and they were يعني, prevalent in Egypt. So when he went there, it was as if they were like, look at this Maliki who's trying to be independent. That's what they were kind of saying. Like, look at this man. He was a follower of Imam Malik. He studied with Imam Malik until he died. Why is he trying to come with something new? They didn't understand, يعني, Sheikh. Imam Shafi'i is his own imam. He can say he's a mujtahid mutlaq. He has the ability to make ijtihad. He has the ability to give fatawa and do ijtihad in any issue he likes. He's a mujtahid mutlaq. Okay? So they had hasad, and he dies at age 54. Wallahu a'lam under what circumstances. Some say that the Malikis, he was murdered, brutally murdered by the Malikis in Fustat. In Fustat. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. I doubt that. I doubt that a talib al-ilm or student of knowledge are going to kill an imam. But he died very, very young. And he was buried in Fustat. He died at the age 44. He left a huge legacy in terms of how we interpret the Sharia. And after the time of Imam Shafi'i, we all follow basically. When it comes to learning fiqh, when it comes to studying usul fiqh, every book which is an explanation of a hadith, by and large, they're following the tariqah of Imam Shafi'i. That's generally speaking. There's no knowledge now since Imam Shafi'i that has nothing, no remnants of Imam Shafi'i. Imam Shafi'i left a mark that could not be changed. And for that reason, in my personal opinion, I regard him as the greatest of all four. I regard Imam Shafi'i as the greatest of all four. And yani, when I was looking into the book, into one of his biographers, which is the one Alim from Azhar, and he was trying to write at the end of the book. The book is 400 pages, very difficult. Yani the old print, some old Egyptian print. Yani it was a PDF. I was toiling to get through. It wasn't the nice new Saudi print. It was an old Egyptian print, maybe from 1970 or something like that. So I was reading it, and the mu'allif, the book, the writer of the book, one of the ulama of Egypt, was trying to decipher what was the thing that made Shafi'i like this? Like, why did he shine in terms of what was it? And he brings some things in terms of, you know, his intelligence, his language, and his ability to understand things, his ability to understand how to deduce. Some people, they're naturally able to deduce things. Yeah, I mean, some people can ask me a question, he can't answer you. You know, how do I get here? And some people, they can think on their feet. They're very quick in terms of their they're very methodical, and he was extremely methodical, was able to deduce things. So I looked and I thought, and we're looking now in retrospect, we can't understand why he was like that. So what I personally believe is that it was a hibah from Allah, it was a gift from Allah. And the reason why I say that is because, having studied in Saudiya, I came across many tulab who all they did was memorize. They memorized. And when it comes to understanding, they had no understanding at all. And then you have some tulab that their understanding was on a different level. You can think this person is going to become a scholar, but his ability to memorize is not that strong, or it's not as strong as it should be. And then you have in the middle, a person who's strong in his memorization, he can memorize and he can deduce. But you don't want to just be a person who can just memorize. And I saw it. When we would study books of ulama, I'll see some tulab, you have two tulab, or five or six tulab, all of them studying from the same sheikh, all of them understanding that particular book on different levels, all of them able to extrapolate different things from one another. So sometimes we'll sit, me and some other brothers, some brothers from America, some brothers from the UK, we'll sit and we'll sometimes read books together, or we'll talk about masail ilmiya. And one of the amazing things was that every single talib, every single brother, I'm talking about the students' brothers, I'm not talking about the brothers who, talking about the students' brothers who came there to study. I remember one thing was that every single one of them always had a wujhat al-nazar, which was different. So this one, he looked at the hadith and he would bring this benefit. Another brother would look at the hadith and brought that benefit. And another brother brought a hadith and he brought another benefit. And there used to be one talib who, he was an amazing student. So when I used to ask him, how did you become like this? He said, "Akhi, I don't know. Like, I don't know." So I'd ask him again. And I looked and we studied certain books, studied certain mashayikh together. So I would ask, he was older than me and another brother, and he would stay with him. But what I began to realize towards the end of my study was that that's just from Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala just gave him that hibah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can just give a person the ability to understand certain things. And when he studies the sharia, his ability to deduct information is greater than another person. And it's just a hibah from Allah. So perhaps what I thought when it comes to Shafi'i was that he's just from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that his ability to understand, his ability to deduce, his ability to, you know, it's just from Allah. You know, maybe somebody might have studied, maybe one of Shafi'i's contemporaries studied as much as him. There could have been people from Shafi'i's time, they studied as much or even more than Shafi'i, but they never became Shafi'i, because this is in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah does what He wills. So that's insha'Allah ta'ala that. Okay, that's basically the end of that. And Imam Shafi'i died in the year 204 after Hijrah, the year 204. So he lived for 54 years, 150 to 204. And he had, he left a large athar ilmi. Does anyone have any questions on this particular topic? Oh, sorry, I forgot, I wasn't looking. Sorry,
Ahmed study under Imam Shafi'i as well?
He did, na'am.
So that's why he's saying everything
about Exactly, na'am. Anybody else have any other questions? Nobody has questions. After all of that, no one has a question. Ajeeb, me, if I was one of you, if I was a talib, I'd have 20 questions. Na'am, tafaddal.
What are the main differences between Shafi'i's first
and then? That I don't know too much. I just think he just looked over his fiqh. A person can change their opinions. The same way, for example, Sheikh Ibn Baz might have had a fatwa, 10 years later he changed his fatwa. Just like that. Just looked over. Maybe just changed his particular view. Yes?
How many countries did it spread to his
brother? Oh, it spread to many countries. So, you have obviously places, so it spread to, obviously, Egypt. Obviously, like places like Ethiopia, Somalia, places like that. Asham. So there's a lot of Shafi'is in Asham. Certain parts of Iraq, Iran, and that whole kind of area. Not just Iran, like the kind of like Iran, Uzbekistan, those kind of places. Now they are no longer Shafi'i, but those places where his madhab spread. And the greatest scholars of hadith, who generally did a lot of khidmah to the scholars, to the knowledge of hadith, in terms of writing the explanations of books of hadith and things like that, there are Shafi'i. So the way I was speaking about last week, that the scholars of Quran were Maliki in terms of the Mufassirun and things like that. Many of the scholars when it came to Ilm al-Hadith were Shafi'i. So Imam al-Nawawi, Imam Ibn Hajar, Imam al-Dhahabi, Imam Ibn Kathir, there's another one I was gonna say. Obviously Suyuti, but Suyuti is a bit later. Ghazali. Yeah, Ghazali, but I'm talking about Hadith. Bayhaqi, Imam Bayhaqi of Hadith. Ibn Salah, Imam Ibn Salah, pioneer of Ilm al-Hadith. You'll learn about him another time. Imam Muqdiman, Imam Ibn Salah. So, يعني great scholars of Hadith. And other ones I haven't named. Hafiz al-Iraqi, Hafiz al-Iraqi. So it's not a joke, يعني. The Shafi'i when it comes to Hadith. It's not a joke at all. نعم. Anyone else got نعم, تفضل.
You mentioned last week that...
What about this week? What about today, this class? Okay, تفضل.
You mentioned Muhammad ibn al-Shaybani last week. Did you say that he became Shafi'i?
No, I said he met with Shafi'i. And he changed some of his views when he met with Malik. نعم, تفضل.
Was Hijaz at that time predominantly Maliki?
Hijaz was kind of everything. Hijaz always never been one madhab. Hijaz has never been one madhab. Hijaz has always been a mixture, it's always been a mixed bag. Na'am, yes, Akhi. Yeah, you, at the end. And then you after, Na'am.
What would be that, from that, 1 to 4, the largest
madhab? 1 to 4? Yeah. The largest madhab is Hanafis in terms of numerical population. After that, and the smallest is the Hanbalis. And then obviously between that is the Shafi'is and the Malikis. I say the Malikis now are more than the Shafi'is. If he was to put all of the different populations together. Yes, Sheikh.
What types of books did you say are based on the writings of Imam Shafi'i?
Oh, all the books after Imam Shafi'i and Usul al-Fiqh. So all the classes of Usul al-Fiqh, Imam Shafi'i, all of them. And most of the great explanations of Ahadith, Imam Shafi'i, all of them. Or people that follow his madhab, na'am. Anyone else have any more questions before we get to... I'm not Shafi'i. And I'm not trying to say, we don't believe, hold on, I want to say something. We're not madhabists, where it's like, a madhab is not something we worship Allah with. Hold, let me get that straight. We follow the sunnah. If there's a hadith, if the madhab says something, and there's a hadith that is sahih, and there's an authentic hadith, and there's a statement of the madhab, then we go with the statement of the hadith. The madhab, the ulama didn't try to say follow me. It was just their questions and answers that from their knowledge of the Quran and Sunnah. So you don't study the madhab to thinking that this is the Sunnah. You study a madhab so you can gain legal, so you can understand fiqh well, so you understand how rulings are derived. You don't study it for the sake of studying it. You study it to actually understand the Quran and Sunnah greater. Na'am. That's it, one question. Subhanallah al-Azim, na'am, tawbah.
Can you study without following?
You can study, but it's going to take a long time. So you can study Sahih Bukhari, Fath al-Bari, which is 30 volumes, or you can study Matan Abu Shuja', that gives you the beginning of al-Islam in terms of how to pray, how to do this, how to do that, how to pay zakat, and you can study like that. And that's what the scholars said. The scholars advise you to learn something small first and then go higher. Even the great alim, who's heard of Muhammad Adam al-Ethiopi, who just died last year. Muhammad Adam al-Ethiopi is a great scholar of hadith. Big scholar of hadith. Shafi'i as well. He said that the talib of hadith should study fiqh before he gets straight into hadith and reading books of hadith. Because you're not going to be able to be grounded in what you're saying. It's just going to be tashattut. You're just going to say, Ahmed says this, Shafi'i says that, Awza'i says this, this says that. You won't understand how these rulings are derived. You have to understand how rulings are derived, so that then when you read the different statements, you're able to come understand them. But if you just start with, you've got zero, and you just open a book of hadith, and you try to understand it, no. But I'm not going to say don't read it. Read it, understand it. But it's not going to be the same. You will not be the same. And scholars of fiqh, يعني, in terms of the Arabic language, in terms of their ability to deduce, they're always of a higher level. Na'am. Anybody else got any questions, or we're going to end it there, insha'Allah ta'ala? Once it's done, there's no other questions that are going to be asked. Na'am.
Was Imam Muslim and Imam Bukhari before Shafi'i?
No, they were after.
And they were in the
There's a big debate. What were they? Every madhab says that they were them. The Hanafi say he was Hanafi. The Maliki says Maliki. The Shafi'i say Shafi'i. Naam. Any other questions? Nothing. Nothing on. If I even get even a message online about this topic, I say, listen, you could have asked me in person. Naam. What was
that? Where can we find that statement of
I can't find you. Maybe you can just find it on Twitter or something. Naam. Or maybe someone of his sawtiyat. But I heard it from a brother who's trustworthy, and I think I saw it as well. I think I saw it. It's on his Twitter page, but probably maybe something from 2018, 2017. طيب إن شاء الله بارك الله فيكم نكتفي بهذا القدر وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد.